Welcome to Game of Thrones Season 2, Crammed. Thanks for all of the comments on Season 1. I hope you've given it a watch because we're going to dive right in. We begin with the Hound beating the shit out of somebody for the entertainment of King Joffrey on his name day, but up next is a drunk knight called Ser Dontos, who Joff is going to have murdered gluttony style for turning up late. However, Sansa pleads for his life and Sandor subtly backs her play. Tyrion is in town back from the war and pleased to see his family, and Joffrey, and it looks like he's going to instill some order. Sansa plays a perfect hostage, and Tyrion meets with Cersei and the small council to act as hand. Cersei isn't happy to see him, which is great, and Tyrion gives her stick for losing Ned and Arya thanks to poor management, and the fact that she has no control over this creep. T-Dog is settling in Ned's old Tower of the Hand with his secret horse Shay, while Littlefinger and Cersei rub each other the wrong way. Up at Winterfell, the old lords test Bran to see how easily he'll roll over, but with Maester Luwin's advice, he's doing okay looking after the place whilst Robb is in the field. He starts to have dreams where he's in the body of his direwolf Summer and spies a red comet in the sky. Osha, their wildling house pet, says a comet means different things to different people, but claims its truth is the coming of dragons. Speaking of which, Dany and her ragtag leftover Khalasars are marching through the Red Wastes. They're sore and tired with the horses dying of starvation, but they must cross because all other directions hold danger and those that would kill them and steal the hatchling dragons. She sends her blood riders off to scout the land in all directions, the signs of hope, and follows the route of a comet herself. Her story is going to be pretty thin this season. North of the Wall, the Night's Watch stop at Craster's Keep. Craster being a wildling who's friendly-ish to the Watch and has a habit of marrying his own daughters to gain more daughters. Jon and Sam wonder what happens to his sons, but in the hall, Mormont is seeking information as to why all the wildling villages have been abandoned. Turns out they've all gone north to join a king beyond the wall, Mance Rayder, an ex-brother of the Watch who's gathering a huge army. And despite being hidden far away over at Dragonstone during Season 1, we finally see what Stannis, dead King Robert's older and less fun brother, is up to. Turns out he's spending all of his time in the company of a red woman, Melisandre, a priestess of the Lord of Light who has a massive boner for burning things and religiously converting everyone in a bid to help Stannis claim the throne. This new religion is upsetting a lot of the old schoolers, however, so whilst we get a flavour for how just and stubborn and humourless Stannis is, their maester tries a suicide poison wine attack on Melisandre, but her magic appears to be too strong. Don't forget the North is at war with the South, so King Robb checks in on his captive Jaime Lannister to give him some wolf heebie-jeebies, and tells him that Stannis is sending ravens to everyone, saying he's the next king in line, because Joffrey and co are just incest babies between Jaime and the Queen. Robb sends terms to the Lannisters about staying out of the North forever, and Theon, who's the son of Balon Greyjoy of the Iron Islands, suggests he go back home to convince the Krakens to lend their ships to Robb's war. Catelyn thinks that letting Theon go is a terrible idea, but her job is to go south and meet with Renly, dead King Robert's other brother who tried to warn Ned back in the day, and see if he wants an alliance with the Starks. Because like Stannis, he's also claiming the throne for himself as king, despite being the younger but more popular brother. And to wrap things up for the day, Joffrey has the Gold Cloaks go around killing all of King Robert's bastard children, including babies, so that nobody can compare their Baratheon bloodline features to that of the Golden Children. Good thing Gendry's been sent off with Arya then, amongst the recruits for the Night's Watch. In fact, whilst Arya is pretending to be a boy and annoying the worst of the criminals from the Dark Dungeons, including this mysterious polite person, Goldcloaks rush up to claim back Gendry, although Arya assumes it's for her, but Euron ain't taking no shit, as this ragtag group now belongs to the Watch. Most of who, by the way, are still loitering at Craster's Keep. With the rumours of Craster sacrificing his sons, Jon follows a man during the dead of night and glimpses what looks to be one of the others taking a baby as a sacrifice. Ooh, watch out. Oh, too late. Craster is pissed off at Jon for snooping around, and despite the fact that he's sacrificing babies, Mormont decides it's just time to move on. Finally. And although Sam wants to take Gilly, one of his pregnant daughters, with them, they're marching north the wrong way. Back down in King's Landing, Varys visits Shay and Tyrion to basically drive a point home that there are no secrets kept from him, and explains that it's important to have friends that can be trusted. While in the city's weird brothels, Oh, no, mate! Some of the whores are feeling sad that a baby was killed here the other day, but Littlefinger makes it clear he doesn't care for sad girls that can't make him money. On the topic, however, Tyrion invites Janos Slynt up to dinner, the leader of the Goldcloaks who turned on Ned Stark's men in a throne room last season, and further went around killing all the bastard children earlier. You see, Tyrion doesn't like scumbags, so Slynt is going to be joining the Night's Watch, whether he wants to or not, and now Bronn is in charge of the Goldcloaks. Not that he's a particularly good person either, just on Tyrion's payroll. Oh, and despite being terrible, Cersei actually thinks she's the only one round here keeping things together, and she further tells Tyrion that he murdered their mother, who died whilst giving birth to him. which is just really harsh. Theon Greyjoy sails home for the Iron Islands to help Robb win his father over to the war, and he's all excited about being an important prince returned home. He talks a bit about their culture of raping and pillage and salt wives and bloody hell, mate. But once he's there, nobody seems to care that much and no one's out to greet him, until this cheeky girl offers to escort him up to the castle on her horse like some kind of Uber. Theon spends the ride trying to get friendly and going on about how awesome he is like a real mouthy prick, but once he gets to the castle, his father thinks Theon has grown to be a soft boy of Winterfell and the Starks. He's forgotten that these hard bastards don't buy pretty clothes but claim stuff for their own. In fact, Balon's planning on claiming a crown for his own too, seeing as everybody else is doing it by attacking the North. Basically, Theon grew up with the Starks as a ward because the Iron Islands rose up in rebellion a while back, which was crushed accordingly, so Balon isn't too happy about that. Oh yeah, and that cheeky bird is actually Theon's sister, Yara, who's more of a kraken than he is. Awkward. Down on Dragonstone, the faithful Onion Knight Sir Davos convinces an old pirate captain friend of his, Salador San, to lend his fleet to King Stannis' cause in return for the plunder of King's Landing when he takes the throne. Davos Seaworth used to be a smuggler in the day, but he's basically just a real honest and simple loyal guy now in support of his king. But he's not taken on the new red faith of Melisandre, quite like the others have. Stannis likes the fleet, but he doesn't have enough strength to beat his younger brother Renly in the field. Melisandre suggests that he give himself to her directly so that she can bear him some kind of son, despite him having a wife. So, of course, they have sex, because if you're not killing somebody in this show, you're banging them. Bran's wolf dreams become stronger, often running in the woods in a body of summer. Maester Luwin is more of a science guy, however, and doesn't believe in such forces. Although he does admit that long ago there were such things as dragons and magic and the children of the forest. Catelyn travels down to meet Renly and his host, who are taking things easy and having a melee. Looks like Loras is beaten by a woman called Brienne of Tarth, who joins Renly's Kingsguard as her prize. Meanwhile, Renly promises to bring Joffrey's head to Cat when he takes King's Landing, despite a little bit of my king versus your king friction. Renly is well loved, but not as much as he loves Loras, despite being married to his sister, Queen Margaery. She doesn't really mind, but if they don't get down and have a baby soon, there's gonna be a problem. Over on Pike, Balon Greyjoy plots to pillage the North with his ships whilst Robb heads south. Theon gets a hard time from his dad and sister for being a weak Starkling at heart and is eager to prove himself. Now, he does almost send a letter to Robb as a warning, but decides to follow the dark side and be a Kraken instead. So he joins the faith of their drowned god, and nobody's impressed. In order to keep her secret, Tyrion has to set Shae up as being a scullery maid, which she doesn't like at all, and over a royal dinner, Sansa tries not to cry her eyes out at the prospect of having to marry Joffrey. Well, Shae is her new handmaid now, and I'm sure that's all gonna be fine. Tyrion tells Grand Maester Pycelle of a secret plan about marrying off Princess Marcella, and he also tells this to Varys and Littlefinger, but each time a different version, all as a cunning trick to discovering who's informing on him to the Queen. Spoiler alert, it's Pycelle. Cersei and Littlefinger are pissed off at being tricked, whilst Varys congratulates the power play before Tyrion pops in on Pycelle and has his beard cut off, before throwing him in a black cell. On their way north, Jorin tells Arya about holding grudges and dealing with trauma, just before the Goldcloaks return to attack the group with the help of Tywin's man, Sir Armory Lorch. Jorin is a badass who, despite a crossbow bolt, takes down a handful of men. But he was only one against many, and now it's time to fight and run. Fire spreads in the confusion, and Arya gives an axe to the guys from the Black Cells to escape with. However, the kids are captured, and Needle is stolen by this asshole who casually kills another boy. But Arya smartly claims that he was Gendry, the boy they were after anyway, basically saving this guy's life. The Stark armies are still smashing the Lannisters, and after another win, he takes a shine to this Volantis girl while she saws off a guy's leg. Romantic. She plays hard to get and Robb likes it. Ugh. God, back to Joffrey again. Because his armies are losing, he has Sansa punished and beaten by his Kingsguard at court. But before she's fully stripped, Tyrion steps up and reminds Joff what happened to the last Mad King when he kept doing whatever cruel things he wanted. Ser Meryn doesn't like people talking back to the king, but Bronn is here, and Bronn can kill him. And Tyrion is impressed at Sansa's resolve at playing a good hostage despite everything. So he gets Joffrey some whores for his birthday in the hope that getting laid might chill him out a bit. But instead he has one beat the other horribly at crossbow points because he's just that kind of king. Cersei's cousin Lancel tries giving Tyrion a hard time on her behalf for imprisoning Pycelle, but he's basically a dumb idiot, and Tyrion gets him to admit that Cersei's been banging him too. So now, worried for his life, Tyrion gets Lancel to continue keeping her happy between the sheets as long as he informs on her for him. Littlefinger visits King Renly as he marches to meet his brother Stannis in a manner that hints at scheming but leads nowhere, because he really wants to meet with Catelyn, who's really unhappy to see him since the whole betraying her husband thing. He lies and says that both both her daughters are captive at King's Landing and suggests that she swap them out for Jaime Lannister. Then he returns Ned's bones, courtesy of Tyrion. In reality, Arya and the other captive boys are taken to Harrenhal as prisoners. This castle has a cursed history and it's currently being run by the Mountain, who picks a new person to be tortured to death every day. After a horrible few nights, it's eventually Gendry's turn, but just in time, Lord Tywin Lannister arrives to make this his war HQ and has the prisoners put to use around the place instead of being just tortured. He clocks that Arya is in fact a girl and makes her his new cupbearer. And reaching the edge of the Red Wastes, one of Dany's riders reports they've discovered the city of Carth, which might be their only hope. So they all head over, but there's a bit of a culture clash at the gate, and they risk being barred entry and left to die. However, one of them called Zaro Zoan Daxos vouches for her out of dragon curiosity, and things are finally starting to look up. Stannis treats with his brother Renly, one is the older and more rightful king, the other better loved with the larger army, but Catelyn doesn't have time for squabbling siblings and tries to remind them of the common enemy, the Lannisters. No good comes of a meeting, however, and the threat of battle between their two armies looms for the next day. That night, however, Stannis gets Ser Davos to pick up his former smuggling skills and sneak the Red Priestess into a cove near Renly's location. If he wasn't unnerved by her freaky sorcery before, then he sure is now, because Melisandre gives birth to a living black shadow that takes dark form. Meanwhile, Renly and Catelyn seem to reach a late-night accord, agreeing on a Stark and Baratheon alliance. But in sweeps the shadow with the face of Stannis and it kills Renly before disappearing. Some of the guards think Brienne must have done it, and Catelyn escapes with her before people get rash. Brienne sees a woman's courage in Catelyn and enters into her service, so long as she's allowed to kill Stannis in revenge. So with Renly now dead, Littlefinger schemes with his former queen before Stannis arrives to take charge of his army. Davos tries to tell Stannis of the creepy shit he saw the other night, but for some reason the king will not hear of it, though he does concede to leave Melisandre at home when he attacks King's Landing. In the capital, Cersei drinks to the death of Renly. She's been drinking a lot lately, and Tyrion discovers that she's planning on using wildfire to defend the city, a highly volatile and dangerous kind of green napalm that the alchemists are brewing up for her. So Tyrion visits the alchemists himself to discover huge underground vaults of the stuff, and takes over the operation instead. Theon gets mocked by his new crew and hatches a plan to actually make a sneak attack on Winterfell, a grand prize that will hopefully make the Ironborn respect him, despite having been raised there. He attacks a town 40 leagues from the castle, and Bran in response has Sir Roderick Cassel take 200 men over there to defend it, leaving Winterfell essentially unguarded. It's then that Bran tells Osha he dreamed of the sea coming up and washing all over the castle. At Harrenhal, Tywin is unaware that his cupbearer is actually Arya Stark, and she discovers that one of the prisoners they were travelling with has embedded himself as a Lannister soldier. Because Arya saved his life and the two chained up with him, this strange guy offers to kill three people for her in return. So first off of the top of her head is a tickler who is torturing people earlier, and boom, falls and breaks his neck. The Night's Watch make it up to the Fist of the First Men, an ancient place where they set up camp and meet with more Black Brothers over from the Shadow Tower, led by Corrin Halfhand, a tough gnarled ranger who plans to sneak over to the Wildling army and kill the King Beyond the Wall before they organise an attack south. Jon volunteers to join them, and a small team of five head out. In the city of Carth, Dany and her crew are treated as honoured guests of high society, and she's further welcomed on behalf of the Warlocks by creepy Priate Pree, who advises her to come visit them at the House of the Undying sometime. This party is full of odd strangers, as a masked woman warns Jorah to stay by Dany's side and guard her against those that would take her dragons. Zaro offers to marry Dany, and with Westeros split, half of his wealth could buy ships and an army for her, although he'll want a dragon in return. And it becomes clear that Ser Jorah is in love with her while she mulls things over. Dany tries to get ships independently from the rest of the 13, but fails. Theon has led a sneak attack and claims Winterfell, and Bran is just like, why? I thought you lived here. He convinces Bran to yield the castle, but everybody calls him a scumbag to his face. And in order to look tough, he has to kill Sir Roderick for spitting on him. He even manages to make a pig's ear of that. Oh, God, I hate you. Jon and the Shadow Tower men are out to kill some wildling scouts before they raise the alarm on the rest of the watch. They sneak up for the kill, but Jon catches a girl, and they question her, but she's fearless. Jon is left to finish her off, but he hesitates, and she escapes for a bit before he then takes her as a prisoner. And then they cuddle up in the cold while she's tied up, so I don't really know what John thinks is happening right now. Princess Marcella is being shipped off south to Dorne as part of an alliance, and Cersei tells Tyrion she'll take away someone he loves for this. Lovely. On the way back from the docks, however, the crowd turns nasty on a royal party, so Joff wants them killed and a full-on riot kicks off. The Fat Septon is torn apart, and after the gold cloaks rush out Joffrey, Tyrion gives him another good slap for being such a stupid piece of shit. Sansa is almost raped but saved by the Hound, who returns her to the keep. At Harrenhal, Arya crosses paths with Sir Armory Lork, so she puts in a panic request with Jack and Hagar, her mysterious murder friend, who gets to Lork just before he gets to Tywin. And Littlefinger, who seems to be travelling everywhere, visits Tywin to suggest a Tyrell alliance by basically having Margaery marry Joff instead of Sansa. Rob and that girl he likes flirt some more at the camp, but his mum is back for the cock block and reminds him he's betrothed to a Frey. Roose Bolton delivers bad news, however, about Theon taking Winterfell, but Rob can't afford to march back home during the war, so Roose offers to send word to his bastard son Ramsay to go kick Theon out. Seeing as Osha was part captive during the good times, Theon decides to free her after she takes off her clothes. But after some bed fun, she helps Bran, Rickon and Hodor escape with the wolves. Meanwhile, Dany's not really getting anything done in Carth until her dragons are stolen and some of her Dothraki killed.
Where are my dragons?
So Theon's angry that the boys escaped and doesn't like to be reminded that he was duped by Osha like a mug. They hunt after the Starks with Maester Luwin, who's not happy to be here, but the boys can't be found. So in order to look like he's a badass, not actually a loser, he kills two random farm boys and burns the bodies to claim their Starks. Jon wakes up, slightly regretting the creepy sleepy with his wildling captive, and she chides him for being a crow that's never had sex. See, the wildling ideology is all about freedom and not being bound by other people's rules, which doesn't work with Jon's outlook. It's gypsies versus houses all over again. Anyway, this girl is called Ygritte, and she tries to convince Jon to join them and be free, maybe even take her for his woman. See, Jon's basically lost, and he can't find the other brothers he headed out with before, oh no, now he's the captive. Down in a ruined castle of Harrenhal, Tywin tells Arya the importance of dragons and legacy over some dinner. Because they're like mates now or something? Even though he still thinks she's just a cupbearer. Sansa thanks the Hound for saving her life, but he spits it back in her face. Clegane is angry at a world full of hypocrisy, and he then discovers that Sansa has flowered, which unfortunately for her means it's soon time to marry Joffrey. And Cersei doesn't even try to pretend that it's going to be anything but miserable for her. She even chills out with Tyrion later and admits that her son is a cruel monster. Over at Robb's Northern Army, the sexy Samaritan is almost luring the King of the North out of his pants by now, while captive Jaime reminisces with one of his distant cousins, who's another Lannister hostage, before he kills the lad to lure the guard in and make his escape. That's dark. And short-lived. Now the dead guard's father, who's the Lord of House Karstark, wants Jaime's head in revenge. And that's causing some serious friction. Jaime's real plan all along. In order to avoid mutiny and the loss of such a precious hostage, Catelyn sends Jaime away with Brienne to hopefully get exchanged for Sansa and Arya. Robb and Lord Karstark are furious at her and send men in pursuit. Dany beseeches the 13 of Carth for help with finding her dragons, but it turns out that the creepy warlocks took them with the help of Zara, Zoe and Daxos, who's been plotting to make himself a king. Those pesky warlocks are everywhere, so Dany does nothing for a bit in order to pad out her story arc. Theon's sister Yara rides to Winterfell to tell him he's weak and stupid for killing the boys. Theon thought she was bringing reinforcements to hold the castle, but she's here to convince him to do something smart for once and leave back for the Iron Islands. He's going to stay, however. The wildlings take captive Jon to the Lord of Bones, don't know where he gets the name from, who has killed the other Black brothers and captured Corrin Halfhand whilst they were away. They're being marched north to see the king beyond the wall when Corrin tells Jon to go over to their side if they'll have him and learn all he can about them, making it look like he hates Jon as a traitor in order to convince the others. The rest of the Castle Black crew are still at the Fist of the First Men, while Sam and friends discover an old cachet full of dragonglass blades and arrows. On the road, Jaime and Brienne sneak themselves a boat, and although Jaime tries to anger her into doing something stupid, she's too stubborn to be goaded by her captive. Tywin Lannister is on the move with his army, and Arya's going to be left with the Mountain's awful garrison at Harrenhal. She realises she's been an idiot for not having Jack and Hagar kill Tywin all of this time, and now she can't find him. And when he does finally show up from patrol, she tricks him into promising to kill himself, unless he now helps her escape with Gendry and this other kid Hot Pie. So that night, they simply walk out of the gates, all of the guards on duty assassinated by different means. Tyrion is planning the defense of the capital, and Cersei tells him that she has his whore who'll be killed if Joffrey ends up dying in battle. She actually has the wrong girl, however, so Tyrion plays along and tells Cersei that he'll one day see her joy turn to ashes. He then goes off to bang Shae, but Tyrion seems to have forgotten that this was an arrangement, and has unfortunately fallen in love. Oh dear. In fact, while on the topic, Rob has fallen in love with the girl from Volantis, Talisa. After hearing her life story and seeing her kind heart, he betrays his betrothal to the Freys by banging her right in the war tent. At sea, we discover that Sir Davos the Onion Knight earned his title when he smuggled food to Stannis at Storm's End in the middle of a siege. And this simple crabber's son has grown to be his right-hand man for his constant, loyal, and honest counsel. And now, in the dark of night, Stannis sails towards King's Landing with Salladhor Saan's fleet. While preparing to defend the city, Bronn and the Hound size each other up as to who's the better killer before being interrupted by the invading army. As Tyrion readies for battle, Varys confides in him that he believes in and despises magic and the dark arts, claiming Stannis must never sit the throne. Tyrion has a plan involving the wildfire operation, and Joffrey makes Sansa kiss his new sword before he defends the city. But she gets the odd cheeky word in now that she's growing tired of his shit. It would be lovely if Joffrey died in battle, but Tyrion is actually doing his best to keep everyone alive by leading the defense. As the bells of King's Landing ring, Davos has the fleet beat the war drums in response, and wonders why the Lannister fleet isn't defending the shore. There is only one ship between Stannis and the city, and Davos realizes too late that it's packed with wildfire. In a single moment, a huge part of the invading fleet is obliterated by the alchemist's unquenchable flames, including Davos's son. Over the press of screams, Stannis pushes on with the rest to land and storm the gates. While Cersei is getting drunk with Sansa and the highborn women holed up in the keep, telling her how much they'll be raped if they lose the fight. Fire arrows rain down on Stannis's force before they reach the walls and make for the Mudgate. But the Hound rides out to lead a bloody sortie, and Lancel Lannister takes an arrow before reporting back to the Queen about the battle so far. So Cersei immediately demands that Joffrey's removed from the walls to safety. Now there's a problem at the Mudgate. The only thing the Hound has ever feared is fire, and these burning men are a bit much for him. So he hangs back for a drink and a rest, and when Tyrion and Joffrey give him shit for this, he says fuck the king and leaves. Joff hides away back to the keep, and all of the defenders almost lose hope until Tyrion steps up, rouses the troops, and leads the attack himself on Stannis's men. Oh, love this guy. Shae sends Sansa to her bedchambers to bar the door, but the Hound is here, tired of everything and drunk. He offers to take Sansa home to Winterfell, but she stays stupid and he leaves. Stannis has a toehold on the battlements, whilst Tyrion's counterattack leads to a bloody mess of a battle, where one of the gold cloaks tries to kill him, but is murdered just in time by Tyrion's squire. As he lays stunned and slipping into unconsciousness, a third army arrives. The Baratheon banner flies, but the new force that's smashing Stannis' men is led by Loras Tyrell of Highgarden, and commanded by Tywin Lannister himself. Stannis is forced to retreat. The Lannisters have won. Also, Cersei was just about to poison Tommen, but I guess we're not going to talk about that? Tyrion wakes, scarred from the battle in a dingy room, and Pycelle enjoys telling him that he's no longer Hand of the King with Tywin back in town. In great ceremony, Joff proclaims Tywin savior and hand. It was Peter Baelish's idea to ally with the Tyrells, for which he's granted Harrenhal. And in a rehearsed bit of BS, they talk of how Margaery never banged Renly, so she's still fresh to marry Joffrey instead of Sansa, who's set aside because of her traitor family. This is great news for Sansa, but Littlefinger reminds her of the creepy truth that Joff is still going to abuse her in lots of ways, in and out of the bedroom. Sir Mandon Moore, the Goldcloak who tried killing Tyrion, did so on the orders of Cersei, and Varys also tells him that his mountain clansmen were paid and sent home, and Bronn was dismissed as captain of the Goldcloaks. Yet despite the scars on his face, Shae still puts on a good show and sticks by his side. It's hard to tell if she means it or if she's still on the clock, but don't get your hopes up. Brienne is still marching Jaime back home for the hostage swap, but when they're recognised by three scumbags, she's forced to murder the shit out of them. Damn. And Jaime's cocky banter is suddenly replaced with regard. Rob is still mad at his mother for cutting him loose, however, and marries Talisa in an unusually stupid move for a king. Back on Dragonstone, Stannis licks his wounds and gets a little wife-beaty on Melisandre for promising him victory based on her visions. But she convinces him not to doubt and continue on to his path of glory. Up at Winterfell, Theon is surrounded by Northmen forces because he was too stupid and proud to leave with Yara. Lewin urges him to run north and join the Night's Watch before the castle is taken, but instead he rallies his men for a glorious last stand that will be sung for years to come before, you know, his own men knock him out and go home. And stab Lewin! While back on the road, Jaqen catches up with Arya and she asks him to teach her the ways of killing. He suggests that she come with him across the narrow sea to Braavos to join the Faceless Men, a cult of master assassins who change identity with ease. Arya has to stay to find her family, however, so Jaqen gives her an ancient coin, some ancient words, and becomes someone else, and leaves. Bran and Rickon were hiding in the crypts of Winterfell this whole time with Hoda and Osha. They surface to discover the castle abandoned and put to the torch. The direwolves are back, but Luin tells them they must head north to the wall and meet up with Jon, because it's too dangerous to find Robb in the middle of the war. Luin is given peace, and there's no longer a Stark in Winterfell. Dany finally goes to the House of the Undying to face their sorcery and tricks, entering the tower alone and seeing a vision of a ruined King's Landing in the dead of winter. She reaches for the Iron Throne, but doesn't quite touch it before following the sounds of her dragons. Her next sight is north of the wall, where she finds Drogo and their son in a summer tent. Again she leaves, and discovers her dragons chained to an altar and surrounded by creepy warlocks. Turns out the world of magic has grown stronger since the return of dragons, and the warlocks plan to keep them and Dany hostage forever to feed their power. But instead the little mites burn the warlock to death. So Dany has Zarozo and Daxos locked in his own vault as a thank you, and sells his stuff to buy a ship. On the march towards the army of the king beyond the wall, Corrin attacks Jon and lets himself be killed for the good of the watch. Jon is accepted amongst the wildlings for this, but back at the Fist of the First Men, Sam and the others hear three blasts of the horn. This is an ancient signal of the watch that means others are coming, and we see a living army of the dead marching on their position, led by a white walker on its corpse horse. Oh my god. So Tyrion's no longer Hand despite his hard work, and Sansa's pretty much exactly where she started. Stannis is beaten for now, and Arya is still trying to make her way home whilst Bran is heading north to the wall with Rickon. Jon is about to play the spy amongst wildlings, and whilst Theon's been knocked out, Robb's been thinking with his dick. But more importantly, the living dead are on the move, and maybe none of that other stuff really matters. And also Dany's about to take a boat somewhere, but to be honest, in the books what she gets up to is way better. So thanks a lot for watching, guys. I really hope you enjoyed having Game of Thrones Season 2 crammed inside of you. After having a look around online, I found plenty of quick catch-ups, but I couldn't find anybody else doing thorough, full-on crams of the season. So if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, and please come click that subscribe button. It really helps me out. I'll see you guys for more crams in the future. You're the best. Take care.